Good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 5th January 2020. For today's discussion, we have taken topics from different areas such as geography, ancient history, science and technology, polity, etc. The link for the handwritten notes in the PDF format and the timestamping for the displayed articles is given in the description box below. And for the benefit of smartphone users, it is also provided in the comment section. Let's move on to our first news article analysis. This discussion is based on the area, physical geography of our syllabus. The article discusses about a method of afforestation known as Miyawaki method. The news article mentions that the Miyawaki method of afforestation is going to be used by Kerala government to add green cover on government office premises, then on residential complexes, school premises, and on Purambok land in Kerala. Now, the Kerala government is up for this intervention because this technique of afforestation is highly successful. Already, it has been adopted by many individuals in the state to increase the green cover in urban areas and in semi-urban areas. So, in this context, let us discuss about this Miyawaki method. This method is pioneered by Japanese botanist Akira Miyawaki. Akira Miyawaki is an expert in study of natural forest and restoration of natural vegetation by using traditional principles. Based on his expertise, he proposed a plan to restore native forests for environmental protection, to restore native forests as a water retention resource, and to restore native forests to protect against natural hazards. See, normally in a natural forest cycle, annual plants on a barren land which have a life cycle for only 1 year are succeeded by perennial grass, by sun-tolerant shrubs, light-demanding and fast-growing trees, and finally natural forests. In this, each step may require decades, and the climax vegetation could be formed after 2 centuries or more only. So to tackle this problem, one reliable forest restoration method is the native forests by native trees method, and this was proposed by Akira Miyawaki. This method was first applied in Japan. He chose various native species of trees that he tested on the substrate to be afforested. Here, substrate is the surface on which an organism lives, grows, or obtains its nourishment. Then after this, he created a nursery where plants were mixed, and then he planted those plants on the site. In this method, Akira Miyawaki implemented and recommended unusually dense plantation of very young seedlings. Here, saplings were strategically planted, which involves growing a great number of saplings within a small area. This in turn produces a dense forest. See, normally in a planting technique, you could have about 400 plants per acre. But in Miyawaki method, around 10,000 plants per acre are present. Now, this density is required to stir competition between species and to stir the onset of phytosociological relations that are similar to natural forests. Now, this phytosociological is the branch of ecology that deals with the characteristics, classification relationships, and distribution of plant communities. Now, in some cases, this density eliminated the need for insecticides and pesticides also. It is because the pests and insects are killed in the competition between the species. Now, let us see the step-by-step method that is involved in this technique. This method first involves surveying the potential natural vegetation of the area that is to be reforested. This potential natural vegetation indicates the potential capacity of the land that is theoretically considered, like which vegetation the area can sustain, etc. Then after this, topsoil of the area is recovered to a depth of 20 to 30 centimeter by mixing the soil and compost. This compost is prepared from organic materials such as fallen leaves, mowed grass, etc. In this way, the time of natural process of soil evolution is reduced because soil evolution is established by the vegetational succession itself. Then after this, tree species must be chosen from the forest communities of the region in order to restore multi-layer natural forests or quasi-natural forests or part natural forests. Now, for having a correct choice of trees based on the reconstructing the potential natural vegetation, several analyses such as phytosociological investigations are required. In addition to this, detection of the soil profile, then topography, then proper land utilization can improve our grip on the potential natural vegetation. So after this step, the field survey is finished. After these field surveys, all intermediate and late successional species of plants are mixed and then they are densely planted. In this intermediate and late successional species of plants belongs to the ecological succession, which starts from pioneer species and ends in climax community, as you can see in this picture. Now, we saw that the species of plants are mixed and they are densely planted. They are planted densely with as many companion species as possible. And then after this, the soil between these plants is mulched. See, mulching is a practice of covering the topsoil surface with organic materials like straw, grass, etc. And this mulching is needed to prevent soil dryness, to prevent erosion on steep slopes, to prevent weed growth, and to protect seedlings against cold. And also this mulching will add as manure, as the materials used for mulching will decompose in future. So these are the steps that are involved in Miyawaki method. Now, in this Miyawaki method, it has been demonstrated that multi-layer quasi-natural forests can be built in 15 to 20 years in Japan, and it can be built in 40 to 50 years in Southeast Asia by ecological reforestation based on the system of natural forests. This method was used in several parts of the world where the results were successful. It was used in Japan, Malaysia, Southeast Asia, Brazil, Chile, and even some areas of China. Now, let us see the advantages of this Miyawaki method. First, it allows quick environmental restorations of strongly degraded areas. Then this Miyawaki method of reconstitution of indigenous forests by indigenous trees produces a rich, dense and efficient protective pioneer forest in 20 to 30 years. And this type of planting results in quick production of multi-layered forest. So eventually it resulted in a soil that is rich with microbial activity like that of a normal primary forest. Then this technique allows effective utilization of land. So it helps in turning a backyard into mini forest, which eventually helps to increase green cover in urban areas. That is why this method will be used by the Kerala government also. And the next advantage is that, as we saw earlier, this method has been tested successfully in Japan. It has been tested successfully in almost all parts of Japan, especially in coastal Japan, islands of Japan, and in ports of Japan, and they were used to mitigate the effects of tsunami. Then this method also makes trees more resilient to storms and high velocity winds. So these are some of the important information that you should know about Miyawaki method. Now, since this method will be adopted by the Kerala government, it assumes significance because Kerala is undergoing the Rebuild Kerala initiative, as last year Kerala suffered floods, landslips and soil erosion. So this method will help Kerala to get its green cover back. With this, we come to the end of this news article discussion. Moving on to the next news article. This news article mentions that a vaccine has been developed by a private limited company in India. And this vaccine has been pre-qualified by the World Health Organization. The company mentioned here is the Serum Institute of India. The name of the vaccine which is developed by this company is Pneumosil. Now, as the name of the vaccine suggests, it is the vaccine against pneumonia. And we know that pneumonia is one of the deadly childhood diseases. So in our today's analysis, we'll be seeing about what do we mean by pre-qualification by WHO. Then we'll see in brief about this vaccine. Then we will also see about Gavi. And finally, we will see few important facts about pneumonia. The syllabus that is relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. Now, as we saw, the news is that Pneumosil vaccine developed by the Serum Institute of India has been pre-qualified by the WHO. This means that WHO has given a certification that the newly developed vaccine meets the global standards of vaccination against pneumonia. Now, the standards refer to quality, safety and efficacy of the vaccine with respect to improving health outcome against pneumonia. The specialty of pre-qualification by WHO is that pre-qualification allows Pneumosil to be procured by United Nations agencies and by Gavi. Gavi stands for Global Alliance for Vaccines and Immunization, and it is also called as Vaccine Alliance. Gavi is an international alliance or an organization that was started in 2000. The goal of Gavi is to improve access to new and underused vaccines for children who are living in the world's poorest countries. They take the cost burden in ensuring the access of vaccines to the children in disadvantaged circumstances. Now, coming to India, the news article mentions that the company already has a license to manufacture this vaccine and also to export this vaccine. Now, with respect to the usage of this vaccine for vaccination in India, it has to get the license from Drugs Controller General of India. The Drugs Controller General of India is the apex authority in the Central Drugs Standards Control Organization, that is CDSCO, which comes under the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. The speciality of this newly developed vaccine is that it is expected to significantly reduce the cost of vaccination among children against the disease pneumonia. So in this context, let us discuss in brief about the deadly childhood disease pneumonia. See, pneumonia is an infection of the lungs. Pneumonia could be caused by bacteria, viruses or fungi. And among the bacteria, pneumonia is caused commonly by Streptococcus pneumoniae bacterium, and it is also caused by Haemophilus influenzae type B bacterium. This bacterium is also called as HIB bacteria. Now, you should know that HIB is the second most common cause of bacterial pneumonia. And among the viruses that causes pneumonia, respiratory syncytial virus is the most common viral cause of pneumonia. And then among the fungus, Pneumocystis jirovecii is the causative agent. Now, the pneumonia infection causes the inflammation of air sacs of the lungs. The inflamed air sacs are filled up with fluid or pus. As a result of this, it is hard for the breathed oxygen to get into our bloodstream. And this pneumonia is often spread through airborne droplets from a cough or sneeze. Then mother-to-child transmission is also possible. Here, the infection spreads through blood during birth. And also know that pneumonia can affect people of all ages. However, two age groups are at greater risk of developing pneumonia and having more severe pneumonia. Now, infants who are 2 years old or younger are vulnerable because their immune systems are still developing during the first few years of their life. And then people who are 65 years or older are vulnerable because their immune systems begin to change as a normal part of aging. Now, because of this reason only, pneumonia accounts for around 15% of all deaths of children below 5 years of age worldwide. And even on November 13, 2019, Hindu News Analysis, we discussed a recently released report on pneumonia and diarrhea. This report is called as the 10th Pneumonia and Diarrhea Progress Report Card, and it was released by the International Vaccine Access Center at the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. As per this report, India is among the 15 countries with highest number of under 5 pneumonia and diarrhea deaths. And among these 15 countries, India has the largest number of deaths of children less than 5 years of age, and that too because of pneumonia and diarrhea. The report also mentions that in 2017, around 2.3 lakh children have died because of diarrhea and pneumonia burden in India. So in such circumstances, once the vaccine gets approval from the Central Drugs Standard Control Organization, it is expected that it will play a significant role in ensuring affordable vaccination against pneumonia in India and also in other parts of the world. So with this, we come to the end of this news article discussion. Moving on to the next discussion. This news article is with reference to the border dispute between two states. One is Maharashtra and the other is Karnataka. The syllabus that is relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. Now, why the issue of border dispute between two states, that is Maharashtra and Karnataka, is presently in news? This is because recently the Chief Minister of Maharashtra has appointed two ministers as coordinators with respect to the border issue. Their role is to oversee the Maharashtra state government's efforts to expedite the case related to border dispute with Karnataka. Here, by case, we are referring to the case of Maharashtra in the Supreme Court. In this regard, you should know the constitutional provisions that are related to the original jurisdiction of Supreme Court. The Article 131 of Constitution deals with this original jurisdiction. Here, the term original refers to at the first instance, and it does not mean by the way of appeal. That is, for the matters mentioned in this particular article, a party can take the matter directly to the Supreme Court. And this Article 131 also mentions that for the matters mentioned in this article, the Supreme Court also has exclusive jurisdiction. That is, no other court can hear these matters other than the Supreme Court. In particular, this article 131 states that Supreme Court shall, to the exclusion of any other court, have original jurisdiction in any dispute that is between the Government of India and one or more states, or between the Government of India and any state or states on one side and one or more other states on the other, or the Supreme Court has the original jurisdiction in any dispute between two or more states. Now, based on this article only, the Government of Maharashtra approached the Supreme Court in 2004 for a settlement. Now, this matter is still sub judice. That means a final verdict has not yet been delivered by the Supreme Court in this case. So, in this context, before entering into the discussion on dispute between Karnataka and Maharashtra, let us have a brief look into the places that is involved in this article discussion. In this discussion, we'll be seeing three states. One is Kerala, then Karnataka, and then Maharashtra. In Kerala, we will see about Kasaragod district. This district is the northernmost district of Kerala. It borders with Karnataka. Then with respect to Karnataka, we will see about Belagavi, which was called as Belgaum before October 2014. This Belagavi district is in the northwestern part of Karnataka. And along with this, we will see other places like Nippani, Karwar, Uttar Kannada, Kalaburagi and Bidar. Now, in this, Karwar is in the Uttar Kannada district of Karnataka. Then Nippani is in the Belagavi district, and Kalaburagi and Bidar districts are in the northeastern region of Karnataka. And both of these districts share border with Maharashtra. Now, with respect to Maharashtra, we'll talk about Kolhapur district. This district is in the southeast part of Maharashtra, and both the Kolhapur of Maharashtra and the Belagavi of Karnataka share the state boundary. And today's news article is also about this Kolhapur-Belagavi boundary only, based on which the governments of Maharashtra and Karnataka are having dispute. Now, with respect to this news article, you should also know about some of the provisions in the State Reorganization Act of 1956. Now, as per the implementation of this act, 14 states and 6 union territories were created on November 1, 1956. We all know that. One of these states was Mysore state. The state of Mysore was renamed as the state of Karnataka in 1973. Then after the reorganization of 1950s, Maharashtra demanded readjustment of its border with Karnataka. For this, Maharashtra invoked section 21, subsection 2, clause B of the States Reorganization Act of 1956. And Maharashtra also submitted a memorandum to the Ministry of Home Affairs. The memorandum mentions Maharashtra's objection to the inclusion or addition of Marathi-speaking areas to Karnataka. So keep this in mind. Then the State Reorganization Act of 1956 also established 5 zonal council for 5 zones of India. In this, Maharashtra was under the western zone and Karnataka was under the southern zone. One of the important functions of the zonal council is that a zonal council may discuss and make recommendations with regard to any matter concerning border disputes. Now, in this regard, the news article mentions that Maharashtra invoked this section to ensure that its border concerns are discussed in the zonal councils. So, what was the claim of Maharashtra? Maharashtra claimed an area of 2,806 square miles from Karnataka. This area involved 814 villages and 3 urban settlements of Belagavi, Karwar and Nippani. The claim is that the entire area was part of Mumbai Presidency before independence. And the claimed 814 villages are spread across Belagavi, Uttar Kannada district, Bidar and Gulbarga districts of Karnataka. Now, Maharashtra claims to seek the readjustment of its border with respect to the claimed areas, and it was based on the basis of 3 grounds. These grounds are geographical closeness or contiguity, then relative linguistic majority, and then the wishes of the people. Now, in this regard, the news article mentions that a 4-member committee was formed initially for this purpose. Some reports are saying that this committee was formed in 1960, and in this 4-member committee, 2 members are from Karnataka and 2 members are from Maharashtra. Now, some reports say that the committee's report went against the Maharashtra government, while some reports, like today's news article, they are saying that a unanimous solution was not arrived at by the committee. So after some time, Maharashtra expressed a willingness to transfer 260 predominantly Kannada-speaking villages to Karnataka. This proposal was like a give-and-take policy or an exchange settlement. The Maharashtra government said that it is willing to transfer Kannada-speaking villages to Karnataka, provided that Karnataka accepts Maharashtra's demand to give 814 villages and 3 urban settlements of Karnataka to Maharashtra. But this offer was turned down or rejected by Karnataka. And even between the 1960s and 1980s, the chief ministers of both the states met several times, but the issue could not be resolved. So this was the stand of Maharashtra. Now let us see about the stand of Karnataka. Karnataka's stand is that the settlement of boundaries as per the State's Reorganization Act is final. Even the news article mentions that initially Karnataka was open to adjust the border in the 10-mile belt reorganized boundary. However, the present stand is that the settlement of boundaries as per the State's Reorganization Act is final. And therefore, the demand of Maharashtra should not be permitted. Now, in addition to border issues with Maharashtra, there is also another demand from Karnataka with respect to Kerala. This demand is to integrate the Kannada-speaking areas in Kasaragod district of Kerala. Then after this, Karnataka is taking its stand based on the report submitted by Mahajan Commission. In this, Karnataka is stating that the report submitted by this commission was final. So what was this commission? This commission is one of the important responses of the union government in the border dispute between Maharashtra and Karnataka. In 1966, because of the sustained pressure from Maharashtra, the center announced setting up of a one-man commission. This commission was set up under the former Chief Justice of Supreme Court of India, Justice Meher Chand Mahajan. He is the third Chief Justice of India. This commission was asked to look into border issues between the Mysore state and Maharashtra. The commission was also asked to look into Karnataka's demand for integration of Kannada-speaking areas in Kasaragod in Kerala. So based on this, the commission submitted its report to the union government in 1967. The commission's report was placed in parliament in 1972, in which the commission rejected Maharashtra's claim over Belagavi city. But this commission recommended the transfer of about 260 villages from Karnataka to Maharashtra and the transfer of about 250 villages from Maharashtra to Karnataka. So in this regard, Maharashtra said that this report was inconsistent and has decided matters in an unfair manner. As a result, it did not agree to certain aspects of the report. But on the other side, Karnataka accepted this report since it was supporting the claim of Karnataka. So based on this report only, the Karnataka government is saying that the Mahajan Commission report was final. This was stated by the present Chief Minister of Karnataka recently, according to this news article. So we have to just wait and watch how this issue unfolds. That is how it will be dealt by both the states, the center and the Supreme Court in the future. With this, we come to the end of this news article discussion. Moving on to the next discussion. This discussion is based on this article which has appeared in today's magazine, and it is about the sorry state of Elephanta Caves. In this analysis, we'll be seeing about Elephanta Caves, then about what is meant by a World Heritage Site, and then we'll also see the present state of Elephanta Caves, which is discussed in this news article. The syllabus that is relevant for this discussion is given here for your reference. These Elephanta Caves are located on Elephanta Island near Mumbai in the state of Maharashtra. Originally, this island was known as Gharapuri. Later, this island was renamed by Portuguese invaders. It was renamed after a giant stone sculpture of an elephant in the island. That is why it is known as Elephanta Island. And the Elephanta Caves present in this island were originally a Buddhist site. Ancient Buddhist stupa mounds can be seen in this island. Later, this island was dominated by Shaivite faith. Shaivite faith is nothing but Shaivism, which is a sect of Hinduism. Shaivism means the tradition which upholds the belief that Lord Shiva is the Lord of universe and the creator of all. Now, since this island was dominated by Shaivite faith, one can see statues depicting Lord Shiva in this site. Then, the Elephanta Caves is a rock cut architecture which was constructed in 5th to 6th centuries AD. And the Elephanta Caves are contemporary with Ellora. And as mentioned by NCRT, the sculptures that are present in these sites show slenderness in the body with sharply defined light and dark effects. One of the main carvings in this cave is the three-headed Sadashiva or Trimurti Sadashiva. If you see our 11th standard NCERT book on an introduction to Indian art, this carving is referred to as Mahesh Murti. And out of these three heads, the central head is the main Shiva figure, whereas other two visible heads are of Bhairava and Uma. So this sculpture represents three aspects of Lord Shiva. One is the creator, then the preserver and the destroyer. Then some of the other important carvings that are present in these caves include the representation of Lord Shiva as Nataraja, Yogeshwara, then Andhakasuravada, Ardhanarishwara, Kalyana Sundaramurti, Gangadhara Murti and Ravananugraha Murti. So just remember that different representations of Lord Shiva are present in Elephanta Caves. Then some of the architectures in this Elephanta Island are important developments of the rock cut architecture. These architectures include the layout of the caves, that include the pillar components, then the placement and division of caves into different parts. And in addition to this, if you see, there is a provision of sanctum or Garbhagriha. So on a whole, we can say that the Hindu spiritualistic beliefs and symbology are finely utilized in the overall planning of the caves. Now, this monument is primarily protected by Archaeological Survey of India with the assistance of various departments of the state of Maharashtra. Now, another important fact that you should know from examination point of view is that the Elephanta Caves were declared as a UNESCO World Heritage Site in 1987. They were declared under the Cultural Heritage Site category of World Heritage Sites. Now, these World Heritage Sites are established under a treaty which was adopted by UNESCO, that is the United Nations Educational, Scientific and Cultural Organization. This treaty is called the Convention Concerning the Protection of the World Cultural and Natural Heritage, and this was adopted in 1972. Now, through this international treaty, UNESCO encourages the member nations which are party to this convention to identify, to protect and to preserve the cultural and natural heritage sites around the world. These sites are considered to be outstanding value to humanity. So as per this convention, the World Heritage Sites are listed by UNESCO and they are listed in three different categories. One is cultural, then natural and then mixed heritage sites. And also remember that India has ratified this convention in the year 1977. So we can tell that India is a state party to this convention. Now, since India has become a state party to this convention, India is expected to protect the heritage values of the properties that have been listed under the World Heritage Sites list. Also, India should report on a periodic basis to UNESCO about the condition of the World Heritage Sites, which are listed out by the UNESCO in India. So, in India, we have totally 38 sites which have been declared as World Heritage Sites. And so far, we have 30 sites which are under the Cultural Heritage Sites category and 7 are under Natural Heritage Sites category and 1 site is under the Mixed Heritage Site category. And this site is the Kanchenjunga National Park. And also remember that the last addition to this list of India's World Heritage Sites was the city of Jaipur and it was added in 2019. And the city of Jaipur was added under the Cultural category. So these were the informations that you should know about Elephanta Caves. Now let us look into the news article. The news article mentions that the spectacular carvings at the Elephanta Caves are degrading with time and they are degrading due to pollution and unregulated tourism. The news article mentions that both the Archaeological Survey of India and the Maharashtra government are not protecting the monuments properly. And the news article also mentions about the comments that were shared by the Indian National Trust for Art and Cultural Heritage on the environmental threats to this Elephanta Island. Now, this National Trust for Art and Cultural Heritage, or in short, INTAC, was founded in 1984 as a private registered society to promote heritage awareness and conservation in India. So, INTAC is not a governmental body. Hence, in 2007, UNESCO granted special consultative status to INTAC. Now, let us see the threats faced by this Elephanta Island, which is mentioned by INTAC. According to INTAC, this island is facing several environmental threats over the years. And one among them is the pollution that is caused by the port activities from the nearby Jawaharlal Nehru Port Trust. Now, in this, know that this Elephanta Island is located between the Mumbai Port Trust and the Jawaharlal Nehru Port Trust. And then next threat is from the chemical storage facilities and oil silos which are present near the island. So there is always the risk of explosion, which in turn will affect the Elephant Island and its rock cut architecture. The next threat is mentioned by a research study in 2015, which has noted that underwater drilling and blasting for dredging the hard rocks for constructing chemical storage sites by Mumbai Port Trust has caused ground vibrations. And the research study highlighted that these ground vibrations may endanger the safety of Elephanta caves. So underwater blasting in the nearby ports is another environmental threat. The next environmental threat is the plastic pollution, which is caused by tourists and the vendors in the island. Then apart from these environmental threats, there is also another major threat, which is vandalism, that is caused by these tourists in the name of taking selfies. So these are some of the threats that are mentioned in this news article. Now, since there are many threats, to tackle these threats, several initiatives have been taken by the past government to preserve this World Heritage Site. And according to this news article, in the year 1997, Archaeological Survey of India even appointed Intact Mumbai to prepare a management plan for the Elephanta Caves. So regarding this, Intact also submitted many reports to the government, but very little work was undertaken at the Elephanta Island. This is because of the revenue earned from the unregulated tourism and the politics that is involved in this matter. Now, since the architecture and the carvings at the Elephanta Caves are degrading due to pollution and unregulated tourism, it is high time for the government, especially the state government, to take enough steps to preserve this UNESCO Cultural World Heritage Site. So that is all about this news article. In this discussion, we saw about Elephanta Caves, then we discussed about World Heritage Site, and we also discussed about threats faced by the Elephanta Caves. With this, we come to the end of this news article discussion. Moving on to the next discussion, this news article mentions about the frauds that were detected at different stages of implementation of the Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana. The syllabus that can be linked to this discussion is given here for your reference. Now, we know that the Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana was launched by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare in September 2018. And this Yojana or scheme aims to provide cashless health insurance of rupees 5 lakhs per family per annum. Now, for the better and effective implementation of this scheme, the then National Health Agency was dissolved in January 2019 and it was replaced by National Health Authority in pursuant of cabinet decision for full functional autonomy. So now the National Health Authority is an attached office of the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare with full functional autonomy. And this National Health Authority is governed by a governing board, which is chaired by the Union Minister for Health and Family Welfare. And this authority is the apex body that is responsible for implementing India's flagship public health insurance or assurance scheme, which is the Ayushman Bharat Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana. Now then, one of the important functions of this National Health Authority is to formulate various operational guidelines that is related to this scheme, and also to formulate model documents and contracts that are related to this scheme. Now this is to ensure standardization and interoperability of the scheme. In addition to this function, the National Health Authority also determines the central ceiling for premium per family per year that is to be provided to the states or union territories. And then it also reviews this ceiling from time to time. Apart from these guidelines related to Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana, National Health Authority also issues anti-fraud guidelines from time to time. This is to check misuse or abuse of the scheme. These anti-fraud guidelines for the Ayushman Bharat Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana is aimed at assisting state governments in designing and managing a robust anti-fraud system in this scheme. And the scope of this anti-fraud guidelines covers prevention, detection and deterrence of different kinds of frauds that could occur in this scheme at different stages of its implementation. And you can see these different kinds of frauds which are mentioned in this table. Therefore, for the purpose of overall monitoring and implementation of this anti-fraud framework, the National Anti-Fraud Unit has been created at the National Health Authority. This National Anti-Fraud Unit is supported by state anti-fraud units at the state level health agencies. Now here, the ultimate responsibility to effectively prevent, to detect and to deter fraud lies with the state health agencies. This is because strong anti-fraud efforts by state health agencies are critical for a zero tolerance approach to fraud in all aspects of management of this scheme. Now today's news is that some of the states like Gujarat, Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh and Punjab were among the states where frauds were detected at different stages of implementation of this scheme. As per the news article, more than 390 hospitals across 9 states have been either served show cause notices, or they have been suspended, or they have been de-empaneled for the alleged fraudulent activities. Now, out of these 390 hospitals, about 171 hospitals have been de-empaneled and necessary actions have been initiated. Now, next, according to the guidelines for the implementation of the Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana, either all packages which are prone to fraud and abuse are reserved for public hospitals, or these packages need mandatory pre-authorization and they also require detailed documentation before claims are paid. However, it was detected that private hospitals were performing these government reserved procedures and they were blocking or submitting these same procedures under a different package name, or they were submitting these packages as a unspecified package. Therefore, it is expected that strong actions shall be taken on these private hospitals for better implementation of the ambitious Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana. So this is all about the anti-fraud guidelines that is issued by the National Health Authority, which is monitored by the National Anti-Fraud Unit. And this anti-fraud unit is conducting regular medical audits to check any violations under this scheme. So these were the aspects mentioned in this news article. Now, for better understanding of the scheme, which is the Ayushman Bharat Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana, we request the viewers to watch the 16th October 2019 Hindu News analysis, where we have covered this scheme in detail. The link for this analysis is given in the description box and also in the comment section, or you can also click the eye icon which is appearing on the top right corner of this video. With this, we have come to the end of news article discussion sessions. The next session will be the practice questions discussion session. Today we discussed about an article which was based on an ancient monument, that is Elephanta Caves, and it is a rock cut cave. So from examination point of view, the rock cut caves are very important. Even previously we have 3 prelims questions based on caves. Let us discuss them one by one. This question appeared in prelims 2013. The question asks, with reference to the history of Indian rock cut architecture, consider the following statements. The caves at Badami are the oldest surviving rock cut caves in India. Now this statement is wrong, because according to the government, the oldest surviving rock cut caves in India are the Barabar caves, and they belong to the Mauryan Empire from 322 to 185 BCE. And these caves have some Ashokan inscriptions also, and these caves are located in the Belaganj block of Gaya district in Bihar. And most of the caves of Barabar consists of 2 chambers and they are carved entirely out of granite. So these caves have a polished internal surface and they also have an exciting echo effect. Now since first statement is wrong, you can eliminate option A and D because the question asks for the correct statement. Then the second statement states, the Barabar rock cut caves were originally made for Ajivikas by Emperor Chandragupta Maurya. Now this statement is also wrong, because if you see the first half, it is correct. The Barabar rock cut caves were originally made for Ajivikas, but it was not founded by Emperor Chandragupta Maurya. This Ajivika sect was founded by Makali Gosala. Now the third statement states, at Ellora, caves were made for different faiths. Now this statement is correct. We know that Ellora is a World Heritage Site and it was made for different faiths such as Buddhism, Hinduism and Jainism. And these caves in Ellora are built in proximity, so they demonstrate the religious harmony that was prevalent during this period of Indian history. So this statement is correct. So the correct answer to this question is option C, 3 only. Now also know that the Badami caves are located in the town of Badami in the north central part of Karnataka, and these Badami caves are a group of 4 cave temples that have been carved out of the hill which is opposite to the Badami fort. And the Chalukyan king Mangalisa was responsible for the completion of these cave temples. and out of the four caves, three are Brahmanical and the fourth one is Jain. That is, one cave represents Shaivite faith and the other one represents Vaishnavite influence, and the third one influences both the Shaivite and the Vaishnavite themes, while the fourth one depicts the faith of Jainism. Now let us see another previous year question that appeared in 2014. In this question, pairs are given and we have to choose the correct pair. The first one is, a grand image of Buddha's Mahaparinirvana with numerous celestial musicians above and the sorrowful figures of his followers below. And it is said that this famous work of sculpture is present in the Ajanta caves. This is true. This statement is correct. And the second statement states, a huge image of Varaha avatar of Vishnu, which is the boar incarnation, as he rescues goddess earth from the deep and chaotic waters, sculpted on rock. And this is depicted in Mount Abu. Now this pair is incorrect because the Varaha avatar sculpture is at Udaygiri caves. It is situated in Sonpura and Udaygiri villages of Vidisha district of Madhya Pradesh. So this pair is wrong. So you can eliminate option A and D because the question asks for the correctly matched pair. Now since the first pair is correct, you can finally arrive at the answer 1 and 3 only, because both the options B and C contain 3, which mentions about Arjuna's penis or descent of Ganga sculpted on the surface of huge boulders, and they are situated in Mamallapuram. Now let us see another previous year question that appeared in 2016. The question asks, what is or are common to the two historical places known as Ajanta and Mahabalipuram? The first statement is, both were built in the same period. Now this statement is wrong because Ajanta caves were built in 2nd to 5th century and Mahabalipuram was built from 3rd to 7th century. Second statement states, both belong to the same religious denomination. Now, this is also wrong because Ajanta caves depict Buddhist denomination and Mahabalipuram depicts Hindu denomination. Now let us see the third statement. Both have rock cut monuments. Now this statement is correct. Both Ajanta caves and the monuments at Mahabalipuram or Mamallapuram have rock cut monuments. So the correct answer to this question is option B, 3 only. Now let us see one practice question based on Elephanta caves. First statement states, these caves are known for mural paintings and rock cut architecture. Now this statement is wrong because they are known only for the rock cut architecture and not for mural paintings. Mural painting means the painting applied to or made integral with the surface of the wall or ceiling. And the second statement states, it is a UNESCO's World Heritage Site. This statement is correct. It is a World Heritage Site which is listed under the cultural category. Now since statement 2 is correct and the question asks for the incorrect statement, you can eliminate option C and A. And you can also eliminate option D because it states none of the above. That means all the above statements are correct, which is not true because statement 1 is incorrect. So the final correct answer to this question is option B, 1 and 3 only. Now let us see why this third statement is incorrect. It is because the painting of Bodhisattva Padmapani is present at Ajanta caves. Even this Bodhisattva Padmapani was asked in 2017 UPSC prelims. So remember that. Now let us see the next practice question, which is based on Miyawaki method. The first statement states, it is a forest restoration method based on indigenous forests by indigenous trees concept. Now this statement is correct because this Miyawaki method is a method of afforestation or forest restoration, and it is based on the native forests by native trees concept or indigenous forests by indigenous trees concept. The second statement is, it has four pillars, namely Jivamrita, Bijamrita, Achadana mulching and Vapasa. Now this statement is wrong because these are the four pillars of zero budget natural farming, in which Jivamrita means a fermented microbial culture. It enhances soil microbiome through the application of cow dung, cow urine and other local ingredients. It provides nutrients to the soil and it also helps to prevent fungal and bacterial plant diseases. And then Bijamrita means a treatment used for seeds, seedlings and any plant material. And then Achadana mulching means decaying leaves, barks or compost, and then they are spread around or spread over the plant to enrich the soil or to insulate the soil. And then Vapasa is providing moisture because the plant roots need lot of water, and Vapasa is the condition where there are both air molecules and water molecules present in the soil. So these are the four pillars of zero budget natural farming. So hence the correct answer to this question is option B only. And the other two statements talks about Miyawaki method only. Now this next question is based on Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana. First statement states it aims to cover primary, secondary and tertiary health care to poor and vulnerable families. Now this statement is wrong because the most important aspect of PMJAY is that it will offer insurance benefit of rupees 5 lakh per family per year, and this insurance will cover medical and hospitalization expenses for almost all secondary care and most of the tertiary care procedures, and it does not include primary care. So that is why this statement is wrong. Then the second statement states the eligible families are identified based on latest national population register. Now even if you don't know about the statement, if you look at the options, you can say statement 2 should be in option because the question asks for the incorrect statement and statement 1 is incorrect. So you can eliminate option B, which does not have statement 1. So from the remaining options, you can say statement 2 is an incorrect statement. Now it is wrong because the eligible families are identified based on the latest socio-economic caste census and not based on NPR. Now the third statement states for wider coverage of the scheme, there is no limit on the family size and the age of the family members. Now this third statement is correct because for wider coverage of the scheme does not involve any limit on family size or on the age of the family members. Now since statement 3 is correct, so it should not be in the final answer. So you can eliminate options C and D, and the correct answer to this question is option A, 1 and 2 only. Now this question is based on pneumonia. Pneumonia is a bacterial, viral or fungal infection of one or both sides of the lungs that causes the air sacs or alveoli of the lungs to fill up with fluid or pus. Now this statement is correct. This is the description of this disease. The second statement states it can spread from one person to another. Now this statement is also correct because it can spread through airborne droplets from cough or sneeze. That is, it is contagious. So your question asks for the correct statement and both the statements are correct. So the correct answer to this question is option C, both 1 and 2. Now this next question is based on Global Alliance for Vaccines and Immunization. The first statement states it is a bureau under the World Health Organization. Now this statement is incorrect because this GAVI is an international alliance or an international organization and it works in partnership with WHO, and it does not mean that it serves under WHO. So this statement is wrong. The second statement is its mission is to improve access to new and underused vaccines for children living in the world's poorest countries. Now this statement is correct. This is the objective of GAVI. Here the question asks for the correct statement. So the final correct answer is option B, 2 only. Now this next question is based on Article 131 of Indian Constitution. Supreme Court has original jurisdiction. Supreme Court has exclusive jurisdiction. Supreme Court has appellate jurisdiction. Now based on this article exclusively talks about the original jurisdiction of Supreme Court. So obviously option A is correct. But if you see the option D, it states both A and B. So let us see whether B is correct or not. Supreme Court has exclusive jurisdiction. Now this is also correct, which means that no other court can hear the matters mentioned in this article other than the Supreme Court. And this is what mentioned in the Article 131 as to the exclusion of any other court. So the correct answer to this question is option D, both A and B. With this, we have come to the end of news article discussion sessions and practice question discussion session. If you like the video, don't forget to like, comment and share. And do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates related to civil service examination preparation.